The town may be kind of small, but these folks have big smiles and big hearts. And they know what it is to have simple fun down our way, where old-fashioned singing and homey gatherings make living mighty pleasant.
I think we spent about $650,000 making Ornament and Crime, and it was set to come out, but it didn't. We finished the album, and we played a show at the Troubadour in L.A., and the next day it was in the papers, like, DreamWorks Records has been sold to Vivendi Universal. This could be bad. And it was. We all got just dropped.
Keep rolling.
Welcome to Abandoned Albums, the documentary podcast where we take a closer look at some albums that may have been forgotten about over time, some albums you might not know existed, and some albums by up-and-coming artists we think you should know about. I'm your host, Keith R. Higgins. And joining me today is retired music journalist, guitar player, kazoo master, all-around music enthusiast, as well as being the scribe behind the brand new Abandoned Albums theme song, Rocket Sled, by his band Blip. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Geoff Calhoun.
Super stoked to be here, Keith.
The paper doesn't give many details. Tell me about this.
On this episode of Abandoned Albums, Geoff and I talk to singer-songwriter, multi-instrumentalist, guitar player, composer, hell, all-around musical polymath, Matt Mahaffey from the band sElf.
Let's talk about the appeal of Matt Mahaffey. It's 1995. Every record label is trying to find the next Nirvana. And sElf, out of Murfreesboro, Tennessee, was one of those bands that labels were rolling dice on, right? They had that kind of Smashing Pumpkins, Weezer, Nirvana adjacent tone that made labels' ears perk up. Their first record was called Subliminal Plastic Motives. They had a single called Cannon from that record. And the trajectory of the band was super interesting to watch because there was a really interesting musicality to their work. I think sElf over time has become one of those like musicians bands where a lot of people that play in bands themselves go, oh yeah, I love that group. But Mahaffey's story is interesting because they really were big time darlings of the scene and kind of anointed as up and comers with that sophomore record, Breakfast with Girls. And they'd been signed to DreamWorks and there was lots of money and hype and radio promises. And they were one of those bands. I think they were too good or maybe even too interesting musically to fit into that stereotype. I think because they weren't Nirvana or Weezer there's a lot of ambition musically to what they were doing. This is an interesting dude. Let's talk with Matt Mahaffey about the band sElf and creating music for movies and television that still kind of has a sElf flavor to it. Here's Matt Mahaffey.
Thank you very much. And I'm glad we got, we connected and got a chance to do this.
Yeah. I'm so sorry. It took forever. We've been crazy busy and we just bought a house in Nashville. So we had to fill it with stuff. Because we live in Murfreesboro, which is about 30 minutes outside of Nashville.
Let's talk about the Murfreesboro.
Murfreesboro. You got to Google John Mulaney talking about Murfreesboro.
I think it was named by a dying Confederate general as he barely sat up in bed eating mashed potatoes. And his grandson was like, Pappy, you got to name the town. And he was like, Murfreesboro.
It was, still is, a very vibrant music scene. And are you still the epicenter? It seemed like you were the epicenter of it in the 90s.
Yeah, we had Spongebath Records. It all centered around Middle Tennessee State University, which had the RIM program, the Recording Industry Management program. And I, you know, being from East Tennessee, I didn't really know what I wanted to do with my life. I knew I wanted to make music because I already was. And I was playing in a country band when I was a kid, and he was like, the bass player, Michael Jeffers, was a good friend of mine. He's like, hey, let's go to this college. They have a recording school. We could be roommates. And I was like, awesome, let's do it. So we moved to Murfreesboro and he instantly fell in love and moved out. So I was just abandoned. It was like this suitcase college. You know, there was like tumbleweeds on the weekends. Murfreesboro is very flat. I grew up in like the hills, you know, and I was just like, God, this is awful. College sucks. And the class, you know, the RIM program was kind of in its infancy. And so you would show up and have a test on music stuff that I just remember being in class. And this guy was like, hey, we haven't gone over any of this. And the teacher just went, and then freaked out and left, and we never saw her again. And it was that kind of level of volatility. And so it's like, this is, you know, you're teaching me how to rap mic cables. I'm recording rappers in the dorm room, that kind of thing. And I would do the extracurricular stuff and, you know, play my songs, and those would get high marks. My 4-track recordings, you know, be a bunch of people playing their stuff, and I'd blow people's doors down. Like, my stuff sounded good. So I was like, okay, that's affirmation. And eventually, as I'm failing tests, like, the same teacher's like, your song ruled last night, F, you know. It's like, this is not something I'm going to learn in a book. It's not something that my dad needs to keep paying for. And I moved to a house, and at that house there was 4 or 5 bands rehearsing there, all because all my roommates were musicians. And so we were just, it was constant. There was just bands being formed around this RIM program. And then, you know, business people started sniffing around. This guy, Richard Williams, showed up and was just like, I'm going to make y'all stars. And like, just trust in me. You do the music, I'll do the business. And I didn't know anything about anything. You know, I'm like 19. And, but next thing I know, we have the biggest building on our little town square. It's like Back to the Future town square. And, there's people bustling around. And, but out of Spongebath, we had a lot of kids move. And to this day, I've run into people that are just like, dude, I moved to Tennessee because of your guys' scene. You know, it was just a lot of really cool bands and a lot of cool things came out of it. Post Spongebath, there was a bit of a scene, but, we really don't have a scene right now. I can't say that because I'm old. The young kids have, we have this thing called Burro Fondo, which is a bike ride around town. So you just get on your bike, you go from bar to bar, house party to house party, and there's all these cool independent artists playing, and I'm dying to do it. I think it got canceled because of COVID, and that's the first year that I was here. I was like, damn it, that's why I'm here. You know, I want to do Burro Fondo. And so hopefully this year I'll get to do it, and I'll get to go just check out all these cool flavors that I, you know, as a dad and a very busy composer, I don't have time to go to the clubs. But they're kind of, I mean, the scene is pretty dead here. My wife and I moved back here too, because my mother's here, and she needed some help. And we don't work anywhere. We don't work in Nashville proper. So we were just like, we can kind of live wherever we want to live, as long as it's within close proximity to my kids. I don't have to be in Nashville proper, you know, moving and shaking. So the borough is like this nice little matrixy bubble, you know? It seems a little more culturally diverse here than Nashville, and no one is up in your business. No one cares. It is, you know, just a very, very laid back place. And, you know, I have a restaurant and that's on the edge of my neighborhood, and I just drive a golf cart to it. And I, you know, it's the nice restaurant in town. So I can, they've carved little paths. Like, I live off of a golf course, so all my neighbors are golfers. They just play golf all day long and then go to this restaurant. So the whole neighborhood's there every night. Very, very Cheers vibe. And we go through their yard and have a glass of wine.
You had a nice taste of success with Canon on the first record. And a lot of those labels came sniffing around because they were, those big labels were grabbing up bands by the armful and, oh, yeah, and trying to find the next big thing. And you guys had a lot of those flavors, a lot of those sounds. So going from Spongebath, which maybe was a more boutique experience, and now the expectations, with a little taste of success, the expectations go up here real fast. Mm-hmm. And that's Breakfast with Girls.
Yeah. I mean, I didn't really feel that. I just was, kind of in my own little world. I think that's one thing that Rick Williams did allow me to do, was just kind of live in this little bubble, and, you know, probably to my detriment. The first record, you know, I had maybe four or five songs written, and then we showcased, and Lou Malia, this old school record exec, flew in from LA, saw the band on our first show, like the first show I ever played guitar at, you know. I was always a drummer. My brother was a virtuoso guitar player, so I'd rely on him for stuff. And I was just making beats, you know. I had samplers. I'm a very backward musician. I mean, I grew up, first concert was Kiss, you know, Sha Na Na, these types of things. Had Kiss records that I would play drums through growing up. Got into recording, got into hip hop instantly because of the rhythm. And my brother was, you know, doing Mixolydian stick scales and studying Dio and stuff. And I was just like, I don't like Dio. I don't like Motley Crue. I like Kwame. I like, you know, I like, you know, Heavy D and Prince. And because my sister was listening to Prince. So it was like Dio or Prince. I'm going to go with Prince. So I had, you know, all these beats, and I was making these demos. I was starting to get attention. Rick was starting to shop them around. My brother had a deal with Elektra. He had a deal in Florida with a band called Blackfish, and they were a major label. They were on a major label. Not Nigel Godrick. Whoever did the first Radiohead record, two guys, Paul Coldry and Sean Slade produced Blackfish. And then he lost his deal, and I was making these beats, and he just called me. He was like, Matt, what are you doing? I'm like, come on. So he came and just put Big Muff on all my beats. And it was like, there it was. Cause Nirvana had just broke, you know? So I was just like, dude, throw some distortion on it. And it was like, there's the sound, instantaneous. We showcased, got a deal with Lou Malia. They had Matthew Sweet and Tool, and then a bunch of other weird bands that, bands like Nature and all these really strange things. We did the record. The label got sold to this guy with a lot of money that didn't know anything about the music business. And he started coming to our shows. Like, we'd be on tour and he would just show up and be like, we're going to sign this next deal. We're going to sign this next record, man. Offer me tons of money, all this stuff. And Rick had already said, like, hey, we're going to jump ship and go to DreamWorks. I think that's going to be a good place for you because they have a film department. And they have an animation department. You got SKG, Spielberg's doing the movies, Katzenberg's doing the animation, Geffen's running the label side. He's like, I feel that there's opportunity there. And that's probably the greatest thing that he ever did to me was be like, let's do this on DreamWorks. And because it was truly where I needed to be, and has launched my post-artist career, you know, is working to picture due to that relationship that I formed with them. I did Breakfast with Girls here at Ocean Way. They just kind of at the time, Michael Austin, Lenny Warnaker, all these legends, you know, they're coming to Nashville, giving me Prince stories, giving me just all their history. And basically there was no rules. They were just like, it wasn't like a Beatles thing of like, give us something for the radio. That'd be great. But it wasn't a prerequisite. DreamWorks is just launching. They wanted it to be cool. They were signing Jonathan Fireeater, Elliot Smith, The Eels, Self, Creeper Lagoon, these really strange, like Blinker the Star, like all these crazy bands. And I'm good friends with Jordan Zatarazny. I'm good friends with Ian from Creeper Lagoon. And we all share stories of like, nope, no rules for me, man. They just wanted it. They wanted us to make weird shit. And that's what we all got to do. And what a lovely thing. You know, they just wanted that reputation of like, we're the cool, weird place. And that was a wonderful thing until none of us sold any records. Then it was just like, all right, boys.
It's a disservice to the record to say it's just hip hop beats with a Big Muff, because you were doing a lot more than that. I mean, the LL Cool J sample, for example.
Yeah.
You're busting down some different doors there.
Absolutely. You know, when I was wanting to be a rapper and making beats, I had initially had this rap song where I sampled, it's called It Gets No Rougher by LL Cool J. And I had sampled my name. So it was like the M, the A, the M, the A, the T, T. You know, it's like, so when I was doing Breakfast with Girls, I was like, oh, the G, the I, the R, the L, the S, S. We'll be right back. I cleared all those samples too. I probably could have gotten away with not clearing that, you know. I think Hank Shockley and LL Cool J took like 25% of the song because I sampled five letters, and it's just from LL running down the alphabet. He's like, let me tell you about an ABC style. The A, the B, the C, the D, the E, the F. And he goes really fast. And then he gets to Z and he goes, it's bullshit to me. And then he kicks in, rhymes with the rhythm of to this amazing song. And I didn't care because I was like, I want LL saying that.
These kids are having a fabulous time with Mr. Microphone, the cordless microphone that actually puts your voice on the radio.
Hey, good looking. We'll be back to pick you up later.
When I listen to Breakfast with Girls, it is just a pastiche of studios and engineers. And I don't really hear, there's some records that I hear that I'm just like, oh, God, I see all the money being spent when I listen to it. It's like watching Rings of Power. You're just like, every single shot is just like, they're just burning money, like just exploding it TNT style. I don't feel that when I listen to Breakfast with Girls. I just do hear like, oh yeah, we did those drums, the verse drums at this studio with this engineer. Oh, and then Ken Andrews flew out and he did the chorus drums. You know, it's like different drum kits. And then I remember being in New York City with Hugh Padgham for a month, which was amazing. And just, it was two 24 track analog machines and a 24-track digital machine all slaved together. It looks like an 18-wheeler in there. And so when he would push playback, those other two machines, it would be like, then the next machine catches up, and the third machine, so it would take a good like 5-6 seconds for all these machines to catch up to each other. And that dude would just turn around and look at me like, you little pissant, like you can't. You have to have all these tracks for your brilliant ideas. Like, can't you just do it on one fucking machine, you little turd, you know? I'll never forget that look. So I see, like, those looks when I listen to this. I'm just like, oh, yeah, this song really pissed him off, you know? Like, because it was a lot of crap. And you're just learning in the process. It's like, I didn't know that Brian Wilson did that shit. I was just doing that out of just, like, and I'm in no way comparing myself to Brian Wilson, but it was out of necessity. Like, the drums have to sound different. It has to be different drums. How do we do that? And we just did it with a lot of tracks.
How did you connect with Hugh Padgham?
That was through Rick Williams. I think he just had, Rick had a way of, you know, he had balls of steel. Like, he would have meetings with David Geffen and jump up and down and scream, you know. He was very charismatic. Still is. He's responsible for, you know, Paramore. He's responsible for Cage the Elephant. Like, the dude can find talent.
Well, and the follow-up to Breakfast with Girls is its own saga. I mean, I, before this interview, I went and put Ornament and Crime on my turntable and gave it a spin. There was a long time when that didn't seem like it was ever going to be possible.
Yeah, it was written and recorded in the proper time. You know what I mean? It was the follow-up to Breakfast with Girls. And we spent a ton of money making it. They made me have a hall monitor, and they were like, you need a producer. So who do you want to work with? And I was like, well, I love the Beastie Boys. How about Mario C and Mickey Petralia? So I did half the record with Mickey P, half the record with Mario C, and Robert Carranza Engineering, great engineer. Rich Costi mixed it. I think we spent about $650,000 making Ornament and Crime. And it was set to come out. It didn't. We finished the album and we played a show at the Troubadour in LA, and the next day it was in the papers like, yep, DreamWorks Records has been sold to Vivendi Universal. And so all my business managers are like, this could be bad. And it was. We all got just dropped. But at the end of the day, there are songs that I do love on Ornament and Crime, but it's stylistically kind of written for, it's like a love letter to K-Rock. They've, you know, all my keyboards are pulled out. My lyrics are watered down to as far as they could whittle them. I wasn't really heartbroken when I found out it was not going to come out. It was like, wow, that was an enormous waste of energy, but it's not my favorite record, you know? And artistically, it wasn't necessarily, it's a little too down the middle of the road, you know?
There are songs on that album that just make me weep that they never got a shot.
Thanks, man. Thank you. Yeah, I mean, nothing was half-assed. It was just like, I mean, the effort is there, but it just, you know, it wasn't, it was a little, it's like, make a Weezer record, whoosh, you know, like turn the guitars up, you know, just sound like everybody else kind of directives, you know.
You felt that was DreamWorks cracking the whip saying sound like Weezer?
You know, I don't blame DreamWorks really for anything other than just like, you need to make something that's going to sell. And that's their job to say that. Yeah, of course. Of course you want to make something that's going to sell. I understand that now more than ever. Like I make in my job now, I make music, more music than I ever have in my whole life, really. And I do it. I get to make music of every genre all the time. And it's just, I realize that I'm a composer because the sElf stuff, these records, it's a million ideas on top of a million ideas, you know, because I only had 3.5 minutes to say what I wanted to say, you know, and that's the problem with a 3.5 minute pop song. Once I got 11 minutes or an hour and a half, I'm able to stretch all these things out. So my death metal is on top of my jazz, on top of my, you know, pop, on top of my hip hop. It's just all side by side and it coexists that way. And it's like, there it is. That's what makes sense, you know, instead of just having 3.5 minutes where a musician is like, holy shit, how, you know, this is cool. But a general listener is just like, it's just noise, man.
you didn't find a lot of general listeners vibing on the blues sample and All Comes Out in the Wash. And then the guitars that come in like, you know, is that like some Black Sabbath stuff, man? That's heavy.
That tune, the Dust Brothers, I was hanging out with them a bunch and really hit it off with Mike Simpson. And he was producing this Dead Man on Campus soundtrack. And he's like, dude, so we're going to England and we're working on this band. Was it, what are they called? Blur? And I was like, you wait a minute. You came to go produce Blur and you've never heard Blur? So he's like, yeah, I mean, what are they like? And I was just like, Jesus, dude. And the track that they did with Blur is so dope. So when he got back, he's like, here's what we did. I was like, this is fucking amazing. And it's really noisy and raw. And I was just literally trying to make a song like that song. it's a badass Blur song. And I was like, I want to do something that sounds like that. And that's all it was.
Oh, man. That song is genius.
Thanks, man.
Fast forward, you know, Ornament and Crime gets shelved, but a piece of it made it out into the world, right? So Grow Up gets released on the Shrek soundtrack.
It was on some sort of Pepsi campaign. I wrote an original song for Shrek.
Is that the point that you thought, oh, there might be something to this animation thing?
Oh, hell yeah. No, I mean, that was it. It was, they wanted their artists to write songs for their films. And they would just be like, hey, come down. Come screen this film. See if you can write a song for it. We want DreamWorks artists in our movies. The first thing I screened was Shrek, like a rough cut of Shrek. And I was like, holy shit, this is the best animation I've ever seen. Like Jeffrey Katzenberg himself came out and was like, hey, you're going to see some finished stuff, some sketch drawings. Just use your imagination. It's going to be really good. And I was like the only dude that showed up, man, you know? And I wrote that shit on the 101 on the way home, just like, I want to stay home today. And then Monday I went in and I sat down. I went and they were like, dude, we're having a meeting about the soundtrack right now. Come play us your song. I go into this little room. I'm all hopped up on Mountain Dew. And it's Mo Austin, Michael Austin, Lenny Warnaker, Luke Wood, every A&R guy. And they were like, play us your song. I played it. They were like, holy shit. Who's your publishing with? You know, my job was to beat All Star. They're like, America's heard All Star a million times, beat it. So that's what I did. Played them the song. They loved it. And then I just remember like Mo Austin having this like senior moment on me. I'll never forget it. I was like, okay, man, I'm glad you guys like the song. Just let me know. What do you want to do? And Mo Austin just went, you go to the theater and then you'll hear it there. And if it's in there, then you'll hear it there. And then you'll know.
Self-assertion, destiny, or slight diversion. Now it seems I've got my head on straight. I'm a freak, an apparition. Seems I made the right decision. Try to turn back now, it might be too late. And it's up to the morning and back again. Same old day, same situation. Happiness is back as if to stay.
That was the gift that kept on giving, because Shrek was a gigantic hit. The soundtrack sold 2 million copies. And then they were like, hey, we really like you. Do you want to score the DVD bonus footage? Like, we're going to do Shrek in the Swamp karaoke. It's this huge medley of all these songs, all the characters singing. Yep, I'll do that. Do you want to do a Walmart companion CD for karaoke? Yep, I'll do that. Do you want to score the Thriller video with all the? Yes, I want to do that. You want to do the bonus features for this? You want to do Far, Far Away Idol? You want to do the roller coaster? Like Shrek was just the gift that kept on giving. Wow. And in dealing with DreamWorks so much, I started working on other movies. Flushed Away. I worked with, you know, Spirit, Stallion of the Cimarron. Next thing I know, I'm working with Hans Zimmer. He's like, dude, you want to come work here? And I'm like, no, I'm an artist. And then, you know, all this stuff. And then I started meeting people at Walt Disney and Nickelodeon and they were like, would you ever do episodic scoring? And I was like, yeah, sure. And then next thing I know, I've got a cartoon in front of me and it's 11 minutes of silence and it's terrifying, but I just had to just start playing something to it. And now I've done series after series after series, all the way up to the Ninja Turtles. I just did my first movie with the Ninja Turtles. And then I just finished my first live action film. It's called Onyx the Fortuitous and the Talisman of Souls.
Andrew Bowser.
Yes, I just scored his film.
I love it.
And it's great.
And I mean this with the utmost respect. What have you said no to?
My brother used to have a theory about the music business called the silver platter theory. Now, what this meant was that if your heart and soul is into whatever you're doing, whatever it is, then you will be able to confidently present it on a virtual silver platter, and everyone will benefit. here's the record, sirs. Yes, it has everything. Here's all the hard work. Here's everything you've asked for. Here's the tasty, delicious artwork. Care for a scone? And I'd say, so we're musical butlers? His point was relationships. Even if the record never sees the light of day, hopefully you've gained a fan in the business that will rally for you in the future on something probably completely different. Because most of the people in the music business are nomadic, and if they respect your work, hopefully they will take you with them. Now, despite being a pushover, I love working three jobs at once. I love the pressure of it, but I'm unhappy. So how did I get here, and how do I change it? I applied my brother's silver platter theory. I gravitated towards working with positive people, and all the jobs that came through that I knew weren't going to contribute a damn thing to a greater musical good, I passed on, even if they paid me more money. And I slowly started to find myself surrounded by positive people doing kick-ass work. And all the people that are in it for a quick buck and, you know, just wanted to exploit me started to fall by the wayside. So by choosing a more dangerous path, I'm coming to a happier creative place. You know, during the pandemic, we landed a lot of shows. And it really helped when my wife started formatting emails, you know, something as simple as that. Like, if someone asks me, hey, you know, pitch for this cartoon, you know, there's this conversation of like, is there electricity? Is there not electricity? Do you like guitars? What artists do you like? What do you hear this show sounding like? And you boil it down to these ingredients. And I would just be like, okay, these are the ingredients they want. It's kind of like brain candy, where they're like, it's a pill that gives worms to ex-girlfriends. You know, it's like, can it also give worms to ex-boyfriends? It's a pill that gives worms to ex-girlfriends. That's the way I view my pitches, you know, like, this is everything you asked for. And it's all, here's the pill. Just that's what you want it to sound like. So I would send the file and I would just say, check it, MM. And she's like, you can't just say check it and then get it, you know, like they don't know music like you know music. You have no idea who's on the other end of this file listening to it. You have to explain like, hey, I made this decision because of this. And the reason why the horns don't work, we used flugelhorn as opposed to a contrabassoon because of this. So when she started explaining things very laymanly, they were like, oh, and we started landing every show that we pitched for. And it was like, we had so many shows coming out. I was like, I don't even know how we're going to facilitate this. But we've been building a company and we have a bunch of people that work with us. So I'm able to... She's like, you work too hard. So I'm able to kind of like direct. And, you know, it's how Hans Zimmer is able to do 50 movies a day is because he has a team of people and he's able to, you know, slap your ass like a bad bean pie if you fuck up. But at the same time, he gets to chill and kind of direct like that. Nope, do this, do that. And be a little more overseeing things. Because the 16-hour days, you know, I just used to be able to do them just all the time. And it's like, if you factor in being a competent father and also doing as many 16-hour days as you can, you kind of, it starts to be a lot. And so I'm very thankful for my wife. And she's basically heading up all our preschool stuff. And we do a lot of preschool stuff, a lot of amazing, big things from Blippi to, you know, a new show that's going to be coming out called Little Baby Bum, which is going to be insane. So we have a preschool wing and then we have my wing, which is like, I want to score horror movies now. After working with Bowser, I'm just like, man, you know, I want every director has a composer. You know, Tim Burton will always hire Danny Elfman. You know, John Williams will always be hired by George Lucas. It's like, all right, Bowser, take me with you, you know.
Right.
I want to give him a ring. Like, will you work marry me? You know, will you art marry me? Like,
if you're not familiar with Andrew Bowser, he has a podcast called Bizarre States that absolutely worth checking out. He and Jessica Chobot are the power team on unexplained phenomenon. It's terrific.
He called a meeting with me a year or two ago, and he was just like, "Hey, I'm a big Self fan. I used to listen to your records when I would be walking around." And coming up with stories. And so we did a short film together called Little Willie, and we just kind of enjoyed working together. So he crowdfunded this movie, and he's done a fantabulous job. I'm proud of the music. And I got to work with a childhood hero of mine. You know, Tish, my wife, had this idea like, hey, you know how all the 80s movies, and this has definitely has like a Gremlins, you know, 80s super cursy kind of feel to it. All the creatures are real. There's no CGI. It's all, everything's built and puppeted. And she's like, we should do like an 80s rap at the end of this. Like, you know, like they would always just sum up in the late 90s or the early 90s. They'd sum up the whole movie in a rap. She was like, who would you want to have do it? And I was like, well, man, I would like, if I had my druthers, I'd say ask Kwame, like Kwame the Boy Genius. He had the polka dots. Like, I just thought he had style. I loved his records when I was like 16, 17, 18. And she just straight up hit him up on Instagram, or we just sent him an email like, hey, would you be into doing this? And he was totally down. And I just mixed it yesterday and it's badass. And I'm like, a 16-year-old me is like, all I wanted to do was work with Kwame and have a race car bed. And now I'm halfway there. So I got this Kwame track. I'm over the moon because I'm really happy. He's super professional, super cool dude. And I'm just so psyched for everybody to hear it.
16-year-old me wanted nothing more than to open for the band sElf. I now have a 13-year-old son who would like nothing more than to meet the guy who does the Ninja Turtles song.
Ooh.
So you're now touching two generations.
Well, that's great.
Ornament and Grime is shelved. You have Porno Mint and Grime, that's like this sister album that you basically self-publish on the website.
Yeah.
And then there's kind of a lull where, you know, Matt starts taking on more producer roles. You know, you're doing some touring with some bigger acts. Mm-hmm. And then your brother passes in 2005. Mm-hmm. That's a lot of tough stuff to deal with as a group. So, you know, the disappointment of having the album not come out and then Mike passing away, was there ever a time where you thought, we're just like, we're done. We're not going to do sElf anymore?
When the deal fell through with DreamWorks, it was kind of like, I had, you know, my thing was like, I want to pay my band whether we're working or not. And we ran out of money and it was kind of like, we ran out of band at that point. And if there's no money, everybody's got to go do their own thing. And that's what everybody did. The recording deal is with me. And the first time I ever saw myself like on a poster by, you know, just with just me, I was just like, I look like a dick. I don't like this. I want to be a band. And, but I also was a freaking control freak in the recording studio and just was like, I want to make the records, you know, the way I want to make them. Everyone is in the band is extremely proficient. Chris James, you know, he just mixed the last couple of Prince records before he died. He did, you know, and he just mixed Purple Rain Live that just came out. I mean, he's crushing it. He just mixed Rumors and Atmos, you know, like he's fucking crushing it because he's got amazing ears. And these are all people that we just, you know, we all met in college and we've kind of kept it together. It's just that it never really was a band and it never really was a solo artist because I couldn't give over. I couldn't, you know, there were talks of like, okay, let's make it like the Beatles. It's everything's 20% all across the board sign here. And I was like, I can't do that because I'm going to be making records by myself. I know that, but I want to make records with you guys, but I just want you guys to do what I tell you to do. What's wrong with that? Sign here. You know, it was, everybody was very, very cool. And they did things even if they didn't want to. And it's hard to keep a band together. And we've kind of done it. We've, you know, we've kind of just been like, we get together when we can. And those types of things. I want to play shows. A couple of weeks ago, my friend opened a club and he's like begging me to play. So I was like, okay. Tish was like, just get some friends. We're in Nashville. Like everybody can, you got kill. Half your friends are these amazing touring artists. They got that charted out. Let's go. So I got two guys up from Atlanta. And then I got a bass player here in town. And we just played a one-off show. And it was very fun.
Look who's talking. Why, someone ought to take you across his knee and give you a good spanking. Might make you more human.
Maybe you're the one to do it.
I'm working on a new album. I've got two songs done, but it's slow going. Very slow going.
The news that you are working on new stuff, like, what's the goal? Full length EP? You know, like, have you got a size in mind?
You know, I'm trying to. I want to make a record, like a nice thick, long one. that's what she said. Anyway,
so many jokes.
So many. What I want to do is a big old record, and you know, my wife has encouraged me to, like, hey, you need to reach out to your contemporaries. You need to reach out to people that are doing what you do and have some friends, you know? So this guy had hit me up on Instagram, and his name's Kane Churko. And he was like, hey, man, I really dig what you do. And if you ever want to work together, let me know. And I get lots of emails like that, and little DMs and stuff. And I just like, you know what? I'm going to click on this guy. And I was like, oh, shit. His dad is Kevin Churko, who worked with Mutt Lang, did all these Aussie records, did amazing things in metal. And so I Googled Kane, and like, here he is doing these demos. Like, here's how you mix metal records. And I was like, holy shit. And I hit him back and I was like, man, you know what? I am coming to Vegas to see Letterkenny live. And I need a date. I was like, you want to come with me? And he's like, hell yeah. So we hit it off. Letterkenny was incredible. So we hit it off, and I was like, here's the deal. I'm going to finish a song. I think it'd be really cool to have a really technical metal mixer mix an album, you know, because it's super technical metal. And he's like, dude, I get hired. He's like, I don't really listen to metal. I get hired to mix it because I'm fucking awesome at it. And that's what my dad does. And so I learned everything from him. And I was like, this might be amazing. So I finished my first tune. I sent the session to Kane. He sent me back a mix a couple of days later. It's amazing. And so I was like, do you want to do more? And he was like, absolutely. So I was like, here's the deal. As soon as I finish something, I don't know when that'll be, I'm going to send it to you. You mix it, and we'll just keep going until we have about 14 of them. And he was like, totally down. So that's where we're at. No stress. Just do it when you do it. And all right, this is totally going to work, you know? And he's super, super talented. So it's going to be slow, but it's going to get done.
Let's recap the irons in the fire here. You've got sElf music that you're working on.
Slowly, very slowly, yeah.
Just did the horror flick with Bowser.
Yeah.
Ongoing work with the Turtles. Ongoing work with series for Nickelodeon. How involved are you with the Dead Deads?
I produced their last album. I think they're writing for a new album now. And that, I don't know if I'll be on this one. I mean, I've done a couple of EPs. It's just like, you've done your time in the Mahaffey town. Just move on.
And what is this? Is it the Germs? The Germs? What
Germs,
is this?
The Germs. How many monthly listeners do we have on Spotify right now? About 14?
Oh gosh, I don't know.
38.
I can tell you real fast.
Oops. My wife and I bonded over our love for They Might Be Giants. I've always tried to write songs in the style of John Linnell. You know what I mean? Like, just, oh, I want to write a song like him or John Flansburg. I just love them. And when we started going on dates, we were just like harmonizing to They Might Be Giants, like the whole records. And we were like, holy shit, this is amazing. And I was like, I don't want to just keep writing songs like them. Let's write a record about them. That would be fun. And so that's what we did. We have the concepts for a whole album. We just ran out of time. We did two of them.
Yeah.
And then ran out of time. But the first one is called Acquired Taste. And it's about trying to take someone to a They Might Be Giants concert and them being like, I don't get it. And then what don't you get?
Come take my hand and walk with me across the Brooklyn Bridge. Let me show you everything I know about two kids that recorded some beats and then sang so sweet about all the cool stuff in their heads. It all happened here, it's been so many years, and tonight you'll see why they're the best. Well, I guess it's an acquired taste. Stop moving your mouth. We're watching They Might Be Giants in Brooklyn Bay.
they played in Nashville, and I was going to give them a thumb drive with those two songs on it. And I even had an in. My friend was like, I'm best friends with the drummer. He knows you're coming. Just hand him the thumb drive. And so we hopped into my buddy's car. Those guys have vape pens, and they're smoking pot. And I think I was just like, fuck it. And I took a hit of it, and I don't smoke pot. So I got really high, went into the show, and as soon as I get into the building, this dude goes, Mahaffey, dude! And he pulls up his pants, and it says SELF down his leg. And I was like, ah, like, I'm high. This is awful. Oh, God. And I just went down a K-hole from that point on. I was just like, this is bad. Like, I can't meet anybody right now. I screwed it up, man.
If you're a SELF fan listening to this and you haven't checked it out, it's GHERM.
Yeah, the Germs. And that's a Nashville term. Germing is someone who gets backstage and is like asking you questions and just up in your grill, and they don't need, it's not the right time or place. So like, you can use it in this context. Like, man, I was back there. I was just trying to get ready for the show, and this dude was totally germing on me. You know, like, you're getting germed. So we're the Germs. We're germing. They might be giants.
You know, I want to ask you about the Expedia.com.
Expedia.com.
How did you come up with that?
Well, Yahoo was really popular. My brother and I were huge fans of Oh Brother, Where Art Thou? We just watched it all the time. And we grew up playing bluegrass. You know, I grew up playing like drums at Dollywood when I was like 11, and it was just bluegrass. So my brother would play that. He'd play that on anything that he would pick up, and we would just laugh because that's the bluegrass riff. I moved to LA, and my friend Jeff Terzo's wife, Pinky, worked at an ad agency. She was like, would you want to do this? And I was like, yeah. My brother was out, and we did like 10 different things. I still have them. They're pretty funny. I thought, like, all these companies, it's always like, ourcompany.com. And I was like, what if we made the .com like huge? What if it was just like, here's our company, .com? And so that's what I did. It was just me going Expedia and then .com. I did my bluegrass guys and I layered it. Mikey put banjo on it. We went hee 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 and we turned it in. Pinky was like, nah, they went with something else. And I had a tiny little hard drive in my computer at the time. So I was like, all right, delete. And I deleted it. And then she called back like a week later, like, actually, they picked yours. I need the session right away. And my brother had already gone back to Tennessee. I was in California. And I was like, man, we got to recreate this thing. So we redid it again. He did it in his garage. And I did it in my place. And we pieced it back together. And that's what aired forever.
Expedia.com.
We're working on a show right now for, what is it? It is for Nickelodeon, I think. It's called Max and the Midnights. We're in the songwriting phase right now. So when you do animation, you have to write the songs first before they animate and get those approved. So we're in the songwriting phase, and all of it's very, very 80s rock, 80s hard rock. So I have all these 80s hard rock sounds up. If we're doing 80s hard rock, I want it to sound, to have a sound like an album. And so... you know, it's kind of shooting myself in the foot, because if I'm doing live instruments, if I write a song, if my wife and I write a song, we turn it in, they're like, hey, speed it up. Well, then I got to replay the drums, because there's only so much you can do with Pro Tools to kind of before it starts getting janked out. So, but it's worth it to me, because I know when I finish this show, I'm going to have this whole, you're going to be able to listen to it in the car on a road trip and be like, wow, that's pretty good songs, you know? And they're really, we started turning in songs, and they were like, hey, we played this for our animation, for our animators, and they were like, whoa, we didn't know we were going to be on a show like this. This is making us want to step up our game. And so it went all the way around to everyone, to where they were just kind of like, hey, we're going to age this show up. So we're going to age it up to like, you know, 12 to 14 year olds, as opposed to, you know, 10 and under. And it was like, so they're like, carte blanche, do whatever you want. I think we're using like, you know, crazy time signatures and heavy, heavy distortions. And my wife is like screaming because she gets to be the voice within Max's head. When Max is doing something heroic, it's Tish just like screaming her face off. And We wrote a song the other day called Holy Crap, I'm Riding a Dragon. <'Cause there's> and sure enough, it came back like, hey, you can't say holy and you can't say crap, especially in secession. We're really pushing it. And it's beautiful CGI animation. It's done. I don't know how they do it, but they like remove frames so it looks like stop motion. It looks like Nightmare Before Christmas or something. But the level of detail is super badass. And we finish the songs. They'll send it back to me, and then I'll score it, which is my favorite part, you know? So that's happening simultaneously. We just got nominated for an Emmy for Karma's World, which is a show we do with Ludacris.
Congratulations.
Thank you. And a puppet show that we did called Barbarian and Troll is up for an Emmy. Damn. No one saw it. It only aired once, but it'll be on, I think, Paramount. I almost said Peacock, Paramount. And it's kind of it didn't do well because it's a story arc. You have to watch. You can't just hop in mid season and be like, no, what's going on? But it's puppets. It's like a female Conan the Barbarian. And it's some of the best songs we've ever written as a team. And I can't wait for it to be on streaming so I can point people and they can check it out. It's really, really cool.
All that on top of being a dad.
Well, yeah, I mean, it would be tough to do everything if it was full time. You know, I guess I would need a nanny. So that is one kind of upside, I guess, to splitting time with your children. It's the only upside is to just be like, well, I can cram all this work. So when I do have them, we have absolutely concentrated time. So, yeah. But it can be exhausting if you don't take care of yourself, which I'm learning how to do. And I want to say also, I really, when you hit me up, Keith, to do this, I really dug I was like, I love the Muffs. I listened to the podcast in my car coming back from Nashville. And it was such a good interview that you did. And then, so the show that I did when I hired the guys and did some self songs, I did Sad Tomorrow, which was just a great song. And it was so much fun to learn. And I think Kimberly Shattuck, I've always said Shattuck. I've always called her Kimberly Shattuck, but it's Shattuck, right?
Yeah.
It's just those four chords. It's like you can rearrange them and it becomes The Lady in the Front Row by Red Cross. It becomes Matthew Sweet's Girlfriend. It becomes anything. The way that she used them is just the most creative way that I've found anybody to use those chords. And I've always loved it. And so listening to your podcast, listening to him talk about her and you asked him, you said, you know, I don't mean to pry, but what went down? And it was, I was bawling, you know, it was like, it was such an amazing story that he told. And, thank you for doing that. It was really eye opening. It's gonna make me cry right now. It was really awesome. And, thanks for doing that. And thank you so much for reaching out to me. You guys, it's good to see you, Geoff. And, you know, thanks for having me on. You know, it's fun.
Thanks very much, Matt. I appreciate it. Thanks for the kind words.
Yeah, dude. Of course.
It was great to see you, buddy.
You too, man.
Hey, it's so great to see you, Matt. Thanks for the time.
You got it.
Yeah, man.
Talk soon.
Take care. All right,
bye.
All right. Bye. The songs you heard during this podcast were Breakfast with Girls and It All Comes Out in the Wash. Both songs are from the sElf album, Breakfast with Girls. You also heard Stay Home from the Shrek soundtrack, and The Germs' Acquired Taste. All of these are available to stream wherever you stream your favorite music. Thanks again to Matt Mahaffey and Geoff Calhoun for stopping by.
Our theme song is Rocket Sled by Blip. Abandoned Albums was recorded at Thunder Love Studios. Produced and written by Keith R. Higgins. Engineered and mixed by Steve Beasley with the help of Mike Hunt. Edited by AJ Royce.
Original music by Mike Pellegrino.
If you like what you've heard, please be sure to subscribe and leave us a rating. It really does help. Thanks for listening.
At Twitter, we are at Abandon Albums. And on Instagram, we are at Abandon_albums.
Grazie.
Bailey Leaf. Rob Janicki. Mike Pellegrino. Therina Vella. Ronnie Barnett. S.W. Loudon. Michael Janicki. Peyton Janicki. And our executive producer.
This is Thunder Love.
Thank you.
And now, until we meet again next time, I remain as always obediently yours.
Abandoned Albums is a production of Paw Print Media.